Extinction is real. Extinction is here.
Extinction is real.
We better say I love you.
I love you before we disappear.
Before we disappear. That's what we're facing. That's the landscape the tour is going into.
Use this music, use this humor, use this belief. All these things we've gathered here. Make our home. Earthalujah. 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 Earthalujah.
There's one kid who comes to the show, and that kid has this eye-opening experience of like, oh my God, there's people like me all over the place doing this crazy-ass shit, and I'm one of these people, and they find their way.
Colonialism has ruled our souls. Even as the curators insist to us that they're giving us the gift of culture.
That they're giving us the gift of culture.
That our government is involved in stealing.
That our government is involved in stealing.
And the theft of culture is an extraction.
And the theft of culture is an extraction.
And the colonial cycle continues. The British Petroleum in the South Australia Sea.
We find out new things about ourselves.
That's the people's mic.
Practice.
Practice.
middle of the day.
One of the values of community is resilience. And I think it's about wildness. And, like, you know, we're city people. We move around in all kinds of ways. We're, you know, on concrete. We're in heavy places, you know. Where do we find the earth? Where do we find the wildness? You know, and mostly we find it together.
Living is living. We got to live. We got to live. But we try to leave and it's like, hey! Did you shout from the crowd in the jail? How we map out our capacity? Then we sing our way across the constellation. We're on the move.
Being part of a bigger voice, to sing with a bunch of people, you become literally a part of this vibrating body, and it's magical.
What are any of us gonna do? This is the ethical thing to do, is to keep pushing. We have to push until we can't push. But what's coming out of COP26?
Nothing.
Let's you and me go swimming.
Let's you and me go swimming.
In the dead zone sea.
In the dead zone sea.
We have a song called And When I Rise. Gregory Corbino's gonna lead the way. Gregory?
And when I rise,
and when I rise,
let me rise,
let me rise,
like a bird,
like a bird,
joyfully,
joyfully.
And when I fall,
and when I fall,
let me fall,
let me fall,
like a leaf,
like a leaf,
gracefully.
And
when I stay,
let me stand
like a tree,
like a tree,
strong and tall,
strong and tall.
And when I lay,
and when I lay,
let me lay.
We're the introducers
like a
lay, of trance,
like a lay,
reflecting all.
We have states, psychological states that we enter into as a result of singing. Belief is a physical trance. If it isn't, you don't really believe. If it's just data or right thinking or theories, you know, that's not where what we're doing in Glasgow can be.
Long traditions of singing at the COPs. Like, we're not reinventing anything.
We can all be
everybody rise up.
How is it possible that we changed our lives so much? That we made it impossible to save our lives. When did it happen? We banned death from our life as if we could. Why isn't it working at all? Why are we killing ourselves?
Beautiful. people will realize that it's not in the interest of the state to deal with the problem of climate breakdown and climate justice, and they never will do anything.
You know, that's what they've always been about, the shopping and about the consumerism and about the toxicity of all of that. But, like, yeah, we just need help. Anyway, we just need help to connect with how we really feel, I think.
Why are we so apathetic? You know, why do we think we can't do something else when this is all we've tried, this capitalist sort of patriarchal system that we live in?
Was Gandhi and Martin Luther King, he was talking about the waves of different thinking about how change is made, you know, and he was saying that, you know, yes, people have studied movements before, but then there's people who just pluck things out of the air. Stuff that shouldn't happen, happens. People put new things together.
Yeah, we've known for a long time, and we don't know what to do. But actually, I think we do know some things to do, right? For one, we know that we have to strengthen our relationships amongst disparate kinds of groups.
The answer is to fight in your territories. I mean, we live on the ZAD, where we fought against an international airport, and we won. Because actually we fell in love with that land. It's really hard to mobilize around molecules, the kind of abstraction of molecules. But when you're mobilizing about protecting a particular piece of land from particular climate-burning infrastructure, such as an international airport, and you're putting your bodies and your lives in the way of it, then it somehow feels so much more tangible and so much easier to mobilize and easier to feel that actually you're changing something.
It's what Billy said about having a harmony in the space and feeling that it can help you go into an unknowing place, it can help you go into a trance place, it can help you connect with how you feel, it can help you, like, I think it can cut through emotional repression. And I think that's the power, and we are so fucking repressed the way that things are.
What I'm saying is, Billy talking about maybe we failed. No, it's a snake shedding its skin. And there are new ways of doing this. This species is extraordinary and capable of extraordinary things.
It's over, you know? COP was their last hope. And nothing meaningful is happening, and they're devastated. So yeah, you see a lot of people crying because they know that nothing meaningful is going to come out of COP. And the activists on the streets are devastated.
What did you do to the great outdoors? And to our children's children, why and why for? Couldn't decide about that thing called life. You wanted more gas, more guns, more sacrifice. Will a child from the future knock on your door? Will she say, I'm a dead kid from 2044? You don't seem to want your future anymore, but the future wants more life, not war. I am the X in extinction, you fools. Your children's children from 2044. I am looking for a vacation in the great outdoors.
Culture.
Wow.
But that space, there's people locked down. There's cops. There's like people who travel from all over the world to be activists. Like there's all this energy, all this commitment. And in a way, it's like a stage, but no one quite knows how to play the stage. I mean, you felt it. It's very intense energy. If you get in and you can just, it's shamanic. But it doesn't happen very often, unfortunately. I live for that. People. Don't do it alone. Do it with other people. Make sure some of them are different than you. Take risks, but take safe risks. Take the risks that you can take.
Earthalujah! 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 Earthalujah!
Welcome to the second event in the Danforth Center's program series this semester on Reverent Irreverence, Parody, Religion, and Contemporary Politics. We're delighted to have with us this evening William Talen and Savitri D, the co-creators of the Reverend Billy Project, a radical performance community now 25 years in the making. For those of you who are able to come a bit early and see the new documentary Earth Riot, you already have a good sense of the climate activism that has become central to their political, artistic, and religious work in recent years. There now is likely to refer to their community as Earth Church, as the Church of Stop Shopping. It has been a long, gleeful, and profound journey. Bill began developing his alter ego, Reverend Billy, in the late 1990s. A street preaching evangelist meets the Frankfurt School and performance art. Savitri soon became the group's artistic director, turning the Stop Shopping Choir into an indispensable part of Reverend Billy's performances, giving a call and response sound to his sermons, whether on the streets, in stores, or on stage. Over the next decade, they became internationally renowned artists, activists, and social prophets, playing prominent roles at Burning Man and in the Occupy Wall Street movement, singing with Joan Baez and opening for Neil Young. Recipients of the Alpert Award in the Arts, the Obie Award, and the Edwin Booth Award, they became iconic dissenters on the left, while attracting the ire of corporate giants like Starbucks, Disney, and Walmart. Clearly, this could be a long introduction, a wordy effort to capture the feel of their creative work. But happily, instead of that, we have compiled a brief set of clips to provide a sense of how the character of Reverend Billy and the community developed. After that short video introduction, we will get to hear from Reverend Billy himself. And then after that, the plan is to settle into a conversation with Bill and Savitri on parody, religion, and politics. So first, our montage.
Greetings, children. I'm Reverend Billy from the Church of Life After Shopping. And there is life after shopping.
We preach an anti-consumerist gospel with the 40-voice Life After Shopping Gospel Choir plus the Not Buying It band. And our director, she directs our stage performances as well as out in public space in the parks and streets. And yes, Starbucks, Walmarts, Disney, sometimes. And she is the love of my life and the reigning mermaid queen of Coney Island.
Every race and every class, every
Savitri D.
Can be together and be free. I love Coney Island. Do you love Coney Island?
Yes.
Inside! That's where the power is! Somebody give me a Freakaluya here today! Freakaluya! Freakaluya!
So, we are an immigrant New York group. We come from many faith backgrounds. We don't have one capital F faith. We're searching, but we're somewhere out there beyond organized religion. All we know is we stop shopping, something special happened, we want to share it with you. Amen.
Fetid inner recesses of these sinners, down in the purses, down in the shadowy wallets,
Reverend Billy. Child, how much credit do you have there? A platinum gold card.
Nobody really goes there anymore except consumers. It's lost. So I had to ask myself, who's shouting here? Who's really getting out there and raising their voice a little bit?
Repent!
It was the sidewalk preachers.
For the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
I went and bought a little pine pulpit. And I was catering tables at the time, so I had a tuxedo. And I just started bellowing.
The Antichrist. We have to start our own church that isn't about the worship of the retail moment. Goofies come to steal the dreams and imagination of your children. Hallelujah. Transnational corporation has been found out. The union busting, the genetically engineered milk, the fake bohemianism. It has come into our neighborhoods like space aliens.
Could you please shut the fuck up?
I asked for the God that is not a product to please nullify, neutralize this cash register now and kick the Starbucks out of this neighborhood. Let's leave now, children. Hallelujah.
That money the other way.
Sir, I need you to leave, please.
I ask the God that is not the product to come through my fingers into this cash register to move all the money the other way. Amen and hallelujah. Change, hallelujah.
Your hands around your back. Your hands around your back.
We've had the very best preachers telling us about it. Thousands upon thousands of natural scientists from around the world have been speaking as one, singing in unison. It came out a couple weekends ago in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC report from the United Nations. They tell us the globe is warming and it is human caused. Why can't we hear, see, touch, feel? The earth is not coming into our senses. Our heads are wrapped in some kind of consumer bubble wrap or something. We're not getting it. We're not hearing it. This wet, white and blue spinning rock in space that is our home is in grave danger. It's warming up. And if there's any change that's going to take place, it's a change that we bring about together. We must radically change our lives. Stop consuming the planet. Yes, stop shopping.
Blessed are the children, for you will inherit the kingdom of bullets and drowning and starvation. May justice comfort you like the dream of a happy family. May the earth reopen its gardens to you.
Welcome. Welcome. Amen. Welcome to the Earth Church. Lee, I could hear that back there, and you overproduced me. Now I've got to
I've got to overpower myself. We're honored to be here in St. Louis at Washing U. My cousin graduated from Washing U. He taught me how to say that. We have a storefront in the East Village of New York. Did you have a whole movie about my storefront? No? Is that new to you? Is that new to you? The Earth Church storefront? Savitri and I blundered into an empty bank, and we found some radical real estate people who were able to give it up to us, and we had a pop-up church. And then we put an X over the U, and started preaching every Sunday in this church. Well, with an X, you can't pronounce it. It's zzz. But we have people in the choir from many different backgrounds, and so we wanted to use the church concept to invite people, but didn't want to go all the way into the God narrative. So this is a year and a half ago. And we've been preaching and singing every Sunday. And we thought we would explore the religious and politics department will understand this. We were trying to experiment with the rhythm of religion, which many organized religions have adopted, the weekly rhythm. Amen? Why? It can't be just arbitrary because too many people do it. Four times every moon. I never really knew why. I just knew that after a while, I really subscribed to it myself. As resistant as I am to organized religion, I thought, well, they have a point. We got through our holiday shows and took some time off, and then understood that all around us in New York, there were more and more and more people coming from all over the world. We could see it, we could feel it, we loved it, but oftentimes we were witnessing a frame around these people, which was they were on the sidewalk, they were sleeping in the subway, they were not in places that struck us as particularly comfortable. Earthalujah. You have that in St. Louis? You don't have a subway in St. Louis? So then at one point, sometime in January, as we started hearing these numbers, 10,000 people a week, 200,000 people in 18 months, we started hearing these numbers. All of a sudden, our mayor makes this statement to the whole group of 9 million of us. This wave of immigration will destroy New York City. And it's coming to a neighborhood near you. Well, here's an African-American Democrat, and he's studying Donald Trump's script. He's testing New Yorkers to see if we will jump. You know, what's our fear pattern here? He was looking for votes. He was looking for, like, to understand our fear patterns. He believed that fear was how you get votes. He was going over to the dark side, wasn't he? Very upsetting. On the F train, when I come in from where we live in Brooklyn, in Windsor Terrace, we go over Red Hook. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You know Red Hook? That's where they filmed On the Waterfront. And there's right. And then there's a hill. It's a transportation hill. It's not a ground hill. It's a It's a highway and railroad hill. And in the middle of it, you can look out the window, and there's Lady Liberty. Well, Lady Liberty is 22 stories high. And I remember when Donald Trump tried to retranslate Emma Lazarus's poem. He said, there's been a misunderstanding. There's another way of understanding this. I don't know what he thought huddled masses could turn into. Seems pretty reduced to its fact, doesn't it? But what was reduced to its fact was what was reduced to its emotion, its basic irreducible thing that each of us carry around in New York. And Americans do too, I think. That we are immigrants and we're welcoming immigrants, and that's a cycle that we're a part of, and it nourishes us and we love it, and it's difficult. We have to share, we have to give up things, but other people gave up things for us and so forth. Amen. Praise be. You with me? All right. I'm not preaching yet. At some point, something happened in the East Village that changed us all. One of the tricks that Adams has to make a hostile environment to discourage these people arriving is to make it difficult to find a place to sleep. And so he has people standing in line in the sleet and the snow, and some of them are encountering their first winter. And they're standing there in flip-flops and T-shirts. And so people in the East Village, I remember we were just kind of in groups of 4 or 6 or 10, and we can't believe it's happening. How is this happening here? How is this happening here? This is not what we think of as our neighborhood. And we, now that place is at 5th and B, 7th and B, St. Bridget's. It's a Roman Catholic something or other, turned into a processing center for the mayor where you get a 30-day ticket so that you can take the subways out to JFK Airport, an hour and a half away, to sleep in a cot in a warehouse. So there they are. They're all standing. All the men are over there, and the families are over there, and they're standing there, and we're just, after a while, we're just giving them blankets as often as we can find coats. We're bringing them, and then finally, I'm going, yeah, well, our little storefront is just around the corner here, and the thing is, they had to give up their place in line, and some of them have been in line for 3 or 4 days, and they're trying to get that ticket, and so that didn't work, and finally, so we just opened our doors. We have thin programming during the week. We can move things around. Let's just have, to fit the shelter schedule for the people who did have tickets, open at 8, close at 4. And then we made an announcement to the East Village community. Who is freaking out? Is this an emergency? Come to the Earth Church. And in 24 hours, the place was packed, 150 people. And we had a dozen working groups. And we were all, some of us were dedicated to boots and coats, gathering donations, and other people were raising money, and other people were cleaning up, and other people were in the language. You know, we have language problem there. We have Portuguese, Arabic, French, Spanish, and some indigenous dialects. And so we're like finding professors, and we're finding people that speak these languages. And we got it together in a matter of days, and then we just opened the doors, and it filled up immediately. Of course it did. The heating. Central heating. And we had young, mostly West African, young African males just wall to wall. It's one room. It's a converted bank. It's a Capital One that we inherited. And it's in, you know, wall to wall. It's about 50 to 60 feet. We can get about really just being shoulder to shoulder in there. About 90 people. Now that's only 4 weeks ago. I'm bringing you up to the present tense here of our project. This is just 4 weeks ago. I think you, from hearing what I could hear in the dressing room, you got a really good education about the previous 20 years. This is the last 30 days. And we did what we could to sustain the English classes so that no matter what language, you could like get around New York, uptown, downtown, and know enough English to deal, negotiate with the bureaucrats. There's the cleaning, there's the feeding, there's the coats just poured through the door. And we had a very crowded situation. So we raised $20,000 and helped a soup kitchen in a park three blocks away to expand its operation. And then some of us went over there. So we didn't have a big enough kitchen in this bank. It's just, you know, a microwave type kitchen. And then there was just so many coats and boots and scarves and socks and gloves. We had to. So we took carts out through the neighborhood. We had a peripatetic, kind of going back to the old East Village tradition of like having a cart, like a rag cart, or vegetables going up and down the streets. So we found ways to like relieve the space and make more space for them. And we could get all the way up to 100 people. So it went on and on and on. And Savitri and I started noticing a feeling that we were having by the end of the day. And our body started anticipating a world beyond simply the logistics of pain and suffering and relief from it and being good liberals. Something else was happening physically. Being with them all day. Now, listening to the garbled English and trying to like determine what is needed. A shoe, a telephone, I would just kind of tour around to the different tasks. I remember there was the task of vacuuming. And so you have to vacuum around all these people if somebody spilled something. And so the way that you do that then, in the middle of the day, you can vacuum at the end of the day, we always do, but in the middle of the day, if you want like potato chips not to be all over the place, then you have people sleeping. They're exhausted. So they're sleeping all day long. They come in and they go to sleep on our carpet. We have a carpet. It's a carpeted bank. They God knows where they've been all night. So gently rolling people over and like so that we can clean up that, having that kind of, doing that kind of, that one task. I remember that one task with this Arman, I think his name was, he's from Senegal, Kawan from Senegal. And it was the eye contact that we had with each other as we did this task that involved the dreams of people who were just so exhausted from this thing that's happening to everybody, and we just rolled people over just kind of a little bit, and the eye contact between us, the way that things were coming into me that I had not anticipated, so far beyond the rights and wrongs and the moral labyrinth of being a good person, so far beyond any kind of self-consideration that I might have. You know, feeling good because you did a good thing, that was not what that was. We were surviving together, doing something together that was necessary to do, and we were joggling somebody's dreams to do it. I remember one time I was in that little kitchen, and I realized the way that people were poking their heads around the door. And the looks on their faces, and the way they would murmur to each other and then look at something, like a Skippy peanut butter jar. And it registered to me that there's a kind of hunger going on here that I've never in my life experienced. And I went out to the local bodega, and the people in the bodega are from Yemen. And I said, we got some hungry people in there. I just want all the rolls, all the tortillas, all everything you can give me, just anything. And I just got a pile of stuff from these fellow immigrants, and I brought it over in big paper bags, and I went in there, and it was just heartbreaking that we didn't know how hungry they were, how they went for the bread. And again, the eyes, it was beyond language. It was sharing sustenance. Suleiman from Gambia. I remember we locked eyes and then looked at the famishment, the reaching down into the bag to get that roll at the bottom, and the way that people tore into it with their teeth. We're all changing. I was doing a turn. I realized that I was walking among them pretending that I was representing New York City. That we were the landlords of this place. We had this central heating. This friendship system. These things were coming towards these people. I realized the extent to which there was a sort of social narcissism that we all had. But I myself, I think I was the fake preacher of this place. And I started gradually descending out of a mountain of attitudes. You know, I was blessing myself. I think there was self-congratulation going on, an orgy of it all the time. I hadn't quite noticed. It was just too much a part of my, oh my God. Anybody here get into like a severe case of the bends from just self-improvement? So I remember that there came a point just like 10 days ago or so, where I was facing the altar of the Earth Church, which is that famous blue marble picture of the Earth from the 70s, and it's we spent $800 to blow it up. It's like 20 by 20. It's just huge, I caught myself looking into the eyes of this man from Ghana, and we were sorting scarves into different lengths or something, or some, was it socks? Or we were sorting something together on that table, and then I looked into his eyes, and we smiled, and I looked at the earth, and then he looked at the earth, and then he looked it back at me. And then I looked it into his eyes, and we did that a couple times. We were looking back and forth from the earth to one another, to the earth to one another. Oh, Earthalujah. The message that I think we were sharing was that our eyes are like the earth. The moving oceans, the moving continents, the birds just above the surface, the radiation, the gravity, all the forces. And I came to believe that I was experiencing something physical, some kind of connection with the earth from these concentrated people that had walked for thousands of miles all over the earth to get to this place. And they're also gracious and happy and bold and curious, always helping out, learning that next phrase, always just walking back and forth and enjoying themselves. They got here.
They got here. They believed in Lady Liberty. I had forgotten, I think. I forgot the dream. They got here. But they put that dream together with this dream of coming so far. Just the physical, the oceans, the boats, the planes, the buses on the rickety edge of Mexican valleys, the walking, and then finally confronting gunmen at the American border and outfoxing them with an asylum story, or like just going up 200 miles, just getting here to New York. Was it DeSantis or Abbott, or was it just you? You got here. Earthalujah, you got here. And now we are in a journey with you. And we're journeying together. Who knows what's going to happen here? The police can come here. The NYPD hates these migrants. Our mayor's a cop. They could just come in here and destroy us. We're three blocks from our precinct house. But every day we're together and we become more and more solid as more and more people in the community come in and help and be with us. And we're making a stronger and stronger earth. It's like a garden. This is the earth. We're growing things we can't see. We're growing things we can't pronounce. The earth is here. Earthalujah. This is the earth, church. In the center of the city, of course, New York, you get the earth, but you get the earth in ways that you can't anticipate. You know, you can't just wait for a David Attenborough special. You got to go outside, and what is outside? Well, there's a strip of blue above Times Square. That's the only earth there. You know, it ricochets off a plane of glass and over here and over here and into your eyes. You know, the light, the feeling, you know, if the white noise parts just a little bit, you can hear a gull. You remember, oh my God, we're on an ocean, because you can forget that for weeks. The earth is speaking to us. The earth is here. Do you feel that? Do you feel the earth coming into our bodies? We are the earth, aren't we? The materials of the earth here. We are the earth. I want you to take a moment to talk to the person sitting next to you about an experience that you had where the earth came into your life in the last while, in the last days, weeks, where you recognize the earth coming in and being with you, communicating through you. Maybe it was a coincidence, something synchronous, something paranormal, something happened. Just on a count of three, I want you to start talking about the earth with each other. One. Ready? Is it coming to you? Is the earth coming up into these brains, or these lovely brains? Two. You ready? Coming up? Three. Talk and listen about the earth for a while.
It's unusual. Yeah. They usually just fly away. Yeah,
I told you this.
Earthalujah. Well, somebody give me an Earthalujah here today. Earthalujah. Earthalujah. What a time we lived in. What a time we live in. The earth speaks to us in personal ways, appearing in a bird, in a wave, on a stream. And I enjoyed so much just hearing some of your depictions. The earth speaks to us in flowers. But the earth, let's face it, is speaking to us in wildfires, and droughts, viruses, superstorms. The earth is life, making life. This is a mass extinction. We only named it extinction because of our personal fear that we're going to be extinguished. It's actually life making life. It's evolution. It's active. It's positive. It happens every 100 million years. This is unusual in that we triggered it and keep it going. But I would say that it's going on its own pretty much now. I don't know. I'd like all the gas and oil and plastics to stop at this very moment. And it seems to me, if you listen to Deborah Whiteplume or Donna Brave Bull Allard or Winona LaDuke, listen to how they talk about this apocalypse that Christians have always imagined. They say, the door is open. We can still participate. We are the earth, and the earth is inviting us to be with her as this extraordinary thing happens. It's not just a narrative in which we die, necessarily. But our death isn't quite the culmination of this plot. It isn't quite the point. That's our social narcissism again. We are, of course, dying. This is the end of the world. This is unprecedented. Every day, the atmospheric rivers pouring down on California. Every day, these extraordinary things are happening. It's like science fiction. It's Ursula Le Guin. It's Philip K. Dick. You just can't believe it. Ray Bradbury. What? It's science fiction is real right now, and that's true. But let's just withstand judgment and try to join in. The earth is expressing its meaning to us. We have no business saying that the earth is not intelligence. We have no business saying that it's not conscience. Every time you pick up a science writing or the Tuesday Science Time, they're saying, oh my God, it's amazing. This parakeet can count to 700. And they're like, once again, amazed that the earth is so smart. No. Stop it. We don't have time for that anymore. Go to the other side. Just assume what's true. The earth is intelligence. The material of the earth moves with itself towards each other. They move and they find a way to make a cell. They make life. Material has intelligence in it and it makes life. There's no outside force. It's in it. It's the earth. It is the earth. Love that. Save yourself from the windstorm if you can, of course. But we have a challenge right now. We are immersed in a crowd of West Africans all sweating. Yeah, we're in a new kind of place with the earth right now. And these defenses, look at those walls, look at this, it's an amazing room here. These institutions are not working. There is no major American institution that believes in climate change, not really. No, for us to join up, we must be radicals.
We must be earth radicals in a way that we didn't expect we would have to be. Like Savitri and me at the Earth Church right now, and we don't know where it's going to end. We don't know where we're going. But we know that our dreams are changing. What we think of, what we imagine, how we talk, who we are, it's all shifting. It's radical. It is radical. As soon as you admit the earth, as soon as you admit that this creativity is so real, this thing that made you and me is active, is going on its own, when we accept that, just accepting it changes us completely. Changes us completely. And you know, you can read Aldo Leopold and his famous chapter with the wolf with the green fire in his eyes. You can have that experience with Rachel Carson. You can do that. That helps. But ultimately, I think it's physical immersion. It's dancing. It's rhythm. It's music. It's the music of the spheres. It's the earth. And we just have to take the time to slow down and go into a forest. Go into your favorite ecosystem. Start talking to the trees. And then listen. Because they will talk to you in some way that you haven't guessed yet, but it's a language you haven't learned yet, but it's a language you will learn. We're babies. But that's the most encouraging thing I could possibly say to you. We're babies. Just learning to think, discovering our opposable thumbs, walking across the carpet and falling on our face. What a pleasure it will be to leave your sophistication behind. Earthalujah, I ask for a radical, anarchic, earthy blessing to come into these wonderful bodies today. All of us. I know I sound like a goddamn Pentecostal preacher, don't I? We have a journey to make right now. It's confusing. We will find ourselves being idiotic, like I just did. The earth will prop us up. This science fiction reality will prop us. We'll be fine. We'll be fine. But we have to walk away from all the decoration. Take what you've got, go into the wind and trust it. We are the earth. And it seems like this era was made for our species. And it does seem as if we blew it. It's hard to imagine that we're not too late. Time to be incandescent. Time to be as alive as an animal. Time to be in the natural world. Ask for admittance. Just go in there naked. Come on, people. We ask for the Earthalujah blessing today. I'm not going to be afraid to resemble some some preacher. That's okay. We'll do it any way we can, right? We'll do it any way we can. The earth is waiting for us. Earthalujah. Earthalujah. What a time we're in. Somebody give me an Earthalujah here. Somebody shout Earthalujah here. Earthalujah, come on. Everybody shout Earthalujah. Earthalujah. Louder, Earthalujah. Come on now, everybody stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up. Earthalujah, shout it out. Earthalujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Let's save each other.
Praise be. I'm gonna walk out backwards now. Like Michael Jackson. Oh no, there's steps back there. I would have. Savitri.
Billy.
Savitri made up this sermon while we were walking across this dead golf course right here.
You sit there.
Okay.
You're supposed to.
Oh, you can have this seat.
Lee, you scare me.
I know I did. Of course.
That's funny.
You know so much more about me than I know about myself.
Yeah. I told you that won't last long, though. I got a short memory. We have a lot to talk about, and even more now after the sermon. But I was hoping that we could, at least pay some attention to our terms, parody, religion, and politics, and start with parody. Mm-hmm. I think what I realized along the way is that that the parody has been overattended to, and early on there was a profile of the group in the New York Times Magazine where it said, if you're going to a Reverend Billy service hoping for a new frontier in sacrilege, you're going to be disappointed. If you're going to a Reverend Billy service hoping for a heavy dose of camp, you're going to find instead this profoundly odd sincerity. The parody is secondary to this profoundly odd sincerity. So I guess the question would be, at what point was it ever a parody, right? Or at what point did you figure out, and maybe this was your work, Savitri, of saying, hey, here's a performance where you've got an obvious parody, this kind of televangelist meets an Elvis impersonator, takes on a gospel choir, and that just doesn't seem serious enough somehow. And you kind of started thinking, well, it's a way to get people beyond irony and beyond parody. It becomes the vehicle. Parody becomes the vehicle to something well beyond parody. So I'm just wondering, is that, did it start off as parody, the fake preacher? Or did you guide it somewhere else when you became artistic director?
Well, I think in the consumer age, this time we're in, whatever we can do to destabilize people's concept of who they are in their role with anything outside of them is good, because we're all trained to be consumers and we're trained to operate transactionally. And whether it's as an audience member or a student or a shopper or a enjoyer of art, that we are so often in that role of consumer or as a citizen. This is the role we have now, right? So I think what we try to do is just destabilize that role. Because humans, yourselves included, are so sophisticated and intelligent, you kind of have to keep that in motion, right? So it's not enough just to be ironic, right? Because everyone knows you're being ironic. And it's not enough to be super creative because they're like, oh, it's art. Or it's not enough to be, a radical leftist because like, oh, that's just politics. So as soon as you're, capturable by a label that then traps you in a sort of commodified relational position, it's over. Right? So I think what we try to do is spin these things around, sort of like, just keep the plates in the air, like those old-fashioned plate spinners, so you don't quite know. So to answer your question, there is no answer to your question. And if you think the parody is gone, that's great. Also, it isn't.
Right. Yeah, and also it isn't. Exactly.
That's about you.
Right, right. Well, I mean, it does seem to have diminished over time, I will say. It is this kind of point. I mean, even Reverend Billy tonight, that line about what a wonderful thing it will be to lose our sophistication. I do feel like that's a message you've had in before, too, that kind of like, it is so possible right now for me not to be ironical at all, or, to get to a place of utter sincerity. Mm-hmm. I mean, to use the Jimmy Swaggart kind parody to kind of get beyond it, right? I mean, that seemed, yeah. So I'm not saying it has to be there to some extent still, but you're right that about that. But I guess another question I had was one of the things you have about this aesthetic around parody is that you talked a lot about sanctified oddness, mm-hmm. and that there's a kind of this carnivalesque aesthetic of these surreal juxtapositions. Reverend Billy, this was preaching in a Starbucks at one point. I got an odd God. I got Mahatma Gandhi and Johnny Rotten and James Brown coursing mm-hmm. through my veins. Or you've got that hymn, we see Goofy and Jimmy Swaggart down in the OK right. Corral. We see the battle of the disastrous religions. We got to be surreal sometimes to understand.
Got to be impossible. I got to be impossible. I got to be surreal. They're connected, right?
Right, right.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering, with the Earth Church, do you still feel like you want to put the odd back in God, or that kind of same aesthetic? I mean, there are connections. I mean, I can see places, but that aesthetic you had with the Church of Stop Shopping, that effect of parody, I don't know. Do you see it as much now, or?
Put the odd back into God.
I gotta say, things are a lot less funny than they were 10 years ago, like 10 minutes ago.
Even 10 minutes ago, that's like, right.
I don't know, can we afford to joke around as much as we used to? Or, I mean, I'm just asking sincerely.
No, no,
sincerely. Like, I think that part of it is a response to, I know there's always been crises. I know that things have always been hard, especially for some people, right? Some places, but I guess the intensity of the crises mm-hmm. has impacted us in a way that makes irony seem frivolous, or like an act of privilege. Like we get to joke around about this while people are being crushed by, I don't know. I think that's part of it. I'm just saying.
Right.
Sincerely,
I haven't used put the odd back in God for years. I think it's because we stopped saying the word God quite some time ago. But I think at the time I was in transition, I had a certain number of people in my audiences that were, Unitarian or on the liberal end of Methodism or Episcopal, and I could see them trying to sort out their relationship to a God that could be treated in a comic way. But now it's the earth. Now it's the earth. Now it's the spirit in all materials. Now it's not so much concerned about, we don't really have time to spend on neutralizing. We don't spend as much time neutralizing consumerism, and religion is a kind of consumerism, or maybe the original consumerism, the original product.
We just have to go straight to the earth. We're just out of time. It's a crisis. Yes.
And also, as carriers of meaning, you know, sometimes you don't want to wrap the meaning in a different package. You just want to carry the meaning and be direct.
Right, right.
And there is something lost in that, I suppose, but I think something more powerful is gained. And also, it's efficiency. It really is about the hurry-upness. Mm-hmm. Like now, listen right now, not after you get the joke. Now. Hear me now. But I'm sure it's not as effective in certain ways as a result. But it ultimately, I don't know that that matters either.
I think people are understanding, I feel it here in this room, the crisis, how we're running out of time or already have run out of time. So I don't think that we have to persuade precisely anymore. Persuading is not, that's been done by the earth.
Right.
Now is the moment of letting the earth flip the culture completely over, which is what it's doing. We're all involved in civil wars. 100 million people are walking somewhere. They have a dream of being somewhere else. I mean, the crisis is happening. So we think that the job right now we have is to find our own communicating with the earth. How are we the earth? How are we a part of this superstorm? How are we in our favorite ecosystem? What place do we have here?
Mm.
So it's moving beyond the environmental movement, which has all kinds of put the odd back in God stuff. It has all kinds of trinkets. Say the truth. That's what Extinction Rebellion in London said when they founded the place back in November 2018, and they stopped the five bridges. Tell the truth. That was one of their breakthrough statements. Tell
funny.
The truth.
It's funny that you even have to say
You're calling me a liar? What? Tell the truth. I think they were addressing politicians and just public spokespeople generally. But that's true. Something about the saturation advertising and just not having people talk straight to each other anymore. Now we have reputational consultants and life coaches, and we have an expert at every turn, and we're like trying to self Frankenstein our way towards the truth. And they're saying, "Tell the truth, see it, say it." Oh, now that was I made a mistake. That was the wrong thing to say.
That's what the cops say. It's okay.
If you see something, say something. Lee?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
What do you see out there?
Where are you going here? Okay.
We still get that all day long in New York.
We
get that in the subways.
You're making Lee nervous.
I can't shout anymore.
No, that's okay. Okay. There you go.
Is this on?
Oh, no, you have a mic on your lapel.
Oh, I do? Am I?
Yeah, you're on
mic. You're doubly mic'd now.
Yeah. Am I louder than I
know?
Wow,
he's ready to go.
He is really ready now.
Am I louder than even I know?
So, right. We'll stop with parody. Work on the truth side of this. So let's talk about religion a little bit more. I mean, one of the things you have continuously done is use the notion of the church, right? Admittedly, there's all kinds of ways people have labeled the project. It's a hard project to label on purpose, you know, with the comic, the political, the artistic, I mean, the spiritual. But church has kind of gone through it. Now, you've always used the word church with plausible deniability. The church that know, what is it? A church for those who would never go to church.
Mm-hmm.
Still, I mean, we've had a lot of labels over time. The Church of Stop Shopping, the Church of Life After Shopping,
mm-hmm.
Now Earth Church. A personal favorite of mine was the Church of the Necessary Interruption.
Yeah, I like that one too.
I'd be willing to join any of these, but if, you know. So how do you think about your community's church? You're still thinking about a church, even if you put the X in there.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of not disguising it. So what is it a post-religious church.
Well, I would say that for a long, long time, all of our work we've never had a space before. We've never had a place of our own before. We've always been on the street, and we've always been out in public space and occasionally in a theater or at a festival somewhere. But our work is out in the world. And in that sense, I think that that sort of beautiful concept of a house not made of hands has always appealed to us, that the word church was just a very fine chalk circle drawn around what we do in public space. And because it explained something about how people gather around their values and express something. And it was just the most simple way of kind of describing what we actually do. So then when we got a space, suddenly I was very uncomfortable with the word church once we actually had a place. Once it was attached to a place, I sort of freaked out. You know, I wanted to call it Big Mountain or something. I didn't want to say, like, I couldn't. So we X'd out that U as a relief from that fear, I guess, that I have of actually being a church. Mm-hmm. Well, it's not just fear. It's aversion, straight up. But, I mean, not because lots of great things don't happen in churches, but just because of, you know, various histories. I think we don't have to go into that so much right now. Right.
Well, Savitri has the wonderful advantage of not coming from a church. I'm looking over my shoulder all the time trying to defend myself against the Dutch Reformed Church, the Calvinists of Holland and Michigan, the psychological abuse of those people. And Savitri's parents invented light shows and went out across the country with Timothy Leary back in 1963. I mean, she doesn't have a church. She's already there.
Well, my first encounter with churches was through the perspective of Native Americans. You know, the first time I encountered churches was being told about churches by Native Americans in New Mexico. You know, and here we sit in, you know, what was once the Illini Confederacy, and this place that was multiple tribes living here. You know, and we honor them and thank them, and we're glad to be here in this place. So my understanding of church starts with a genocide. And so co-opting that word, using that word, is an effort at healing, I guess I would say. And then also, you know, there's the aversion and the and the real fear of that and what it's done to people, not just then, but in recent years too, right now as we speak.
Right.
Can't get around that.
No. Which is, you know, part of, right, the irony of using it still. Or again, but you're using, I do feel like, even if we're bracketing out the humor a little bit, there is this quotation effect. I mean, we know that you're using it in a very particular post-religious way. So there is a kind of layer there.
Well, it's masking too, right? Yeah, it's a sort of theatrical.
Right, right.
Right? It's masking, yeah, I'd say. Right. It's a costume.
Right.
And it is disarming to people as activists when they don't know what you are.
Right.
Because the minute you're a protester, Lee, you don't matter to people. They just glaze over.
You can't be a protester anymore. That
you can't do that.
It's dismissed in a moment.
It doesn't mean anything to anyone who isn't a protester.
It's exciting to us about the Earth Church. We don't know what it is, but other people don't either. You know?
That's...
That's a good one.
Keep people on
edge. I was taught by my teacher, Sidney Lanier, who's a lapsed Episcopal preacher. And Sidney said, "Why are you so afraid of Christians? And why do you demonize the Calvinists? They just had a..." You know, they come from Switzerland, and they had a history, and you know, I tried to describe the abuse of my childhood as best I can. I mean, he was unimpressed by my abuse, and he said, "Look, You know, so Sidney, a little bit of history. Sidney lived in New York with his cousin, Thomas Lanier Williams. And he and Tennessee were, you know, they were heroes and cultural heroes of mine. And Sidney used his cousin as a demonstration of what a mistake it is to really just be afraid of and distance yourself constantly from the main religion of the country, and then try to be a cultural political person in this country. He says, they don't go together. And he said, Tennessee Williams was never a Christian, but his plays are out of the Bible. The Fugitive Kind, Marlon Brando comes into a town. So Sidney took me to The Fugitive Kind. It was like one of those, one of those art movie theaters. So the fugitive, he said, look at this. It's a Jesus story. And Jesus, and Sidney was scaring me. He had the Bible with him. And he said, now check this out. So Marlon Brando comes into this little southern town. And no one knows where he's from. Nobody knows anything about him. He just seems to be, and he's not impressed by anybody, and he rarely talks. And then what's her name? Magnani, the kind of matriarch of the town, the wife of the big man or something, the richest person there, falls in love with him. And then they have they start becoming this evil couple to the people in the town, and they eventually kill Marlon Brando. So he said, this is a Jesus story. And he went right to St. Mark, and he said, this is it. And then Sidney took me to a Clint Eastwood movie, High Plains Drifter. He said, here he comes again. Here's Clint Eastwood. Nobody knows where he's from. He seems terribly wounded. He really is a good shot. Here he comes on his horse, and he comes into a little town, and a gang from a local mining company is terrorizing the town, murdering everybody, and one by one, he like infiltrates their dreams, and yep, once again, the mayor's wife falls in love with him. So the Mary Magdalene figure, you know. So he takes me through, he taught me that serious political moralists who are really, really wanting to change the average American are quite aware that Americans are not French philosophers, that we make our meaning from little compacted, very repetitive morality tales.
And it's so charged.
Little stories.
It's just so charged. I mean, that's the other thing. When you're a theater person or when you're trying to identify and sort of elevate these moments where you can have intensity with people, where you can shimmer and a third thing can happen between you and another. And these stories and the question of religiosity or the question of faith, it is such a charged story in this country. And I remember the first time I encountered Reverend Billy, and I happened to already be dating him at the time, and I was like shocked. I was shocked. I was like, I can't believe this. It's such a weird instrument, you know, but it was so, there was so much tension, and there were always people like getting really angry and upset and crying and like leaving and throwing things, and there was just so much hostility. I thought there's something here that's just really powerful in this tension.
Thank you, darling.
Yeah. Misgivings now, but at the time it seemed like a good idea.
So I one question about politics. I want to give some time for people to ask some questions as well. So I guess, I mean, we talked a good amount, especially in the sermon, about the contemporary last 30 days, how intense the politics around immigration has become and how important this has become to the church. One question I did have, since we're going into an election year, as horrible as that is to think, is the relationship of your work to electoral politics. I mean, you both have these anarchic sensibilities and interests, but you did run for mayor at one point, which did against Bloomberg on the Green Party ticket. So there's some interest in electoral politics.
Well, so somebody had to do that. Okay, Michael Bloomberg was hijacking. We had term limits in New York City. Mm-hmm. He overturned them. I mean, he was really betraying the democracy mm-hmm. of our city. Mm-hmm. And really, somebody just had to run against him. It just had to, other than a Republican or... So right. We really did that for that reason. Someone had to say no to him, mm-hmm. you know, and that was saying no to corporate democracy because that's what Michael Bloomberg was, you know.
Right. So,
so it was very much part of the work we were doing at the time, right. resisting corporations generally. He was just a corporation in the body of a human. Do you know what I mean?
Corporations are people.
Well, that one is. You know, that, so, yes, that one.
But today I heard you say, Bill, that was a disaster running for
us. Yes,
it was a horrible experience.
Yeah.
It needed to be done, but it was a horrible experience.
Terrible.
I ended up in the hospital. Savitri got the swine flu.
Yeah. Also, we lost a lot of friends. I mean, the thing is, you lose credibility when you run for office. I mean, I think everyone should do it because it's a remarkable experience, and our democracy would be very different if all of us had to run for office once in our life and just feel what it's like. It is like a sausage machine. I mean, you go in one side and you come out a completely different shape. It's really troubling what it is and what credibility and what legitimacy looks like in that mm-hmm. in that arena. It's shocking. No matter who you are, you have to perform this very narrow role. It's very narrow, very choreographed, you know, assembled essentially out of like the shards of the patriarchy. It's terrible.
So you lost friends presumably because you have, you know, anarchist friends who thought this was a crazy idea for you to get involved with this kind of.
I mean, certainly the anarchists. Some of them still don't speak to us, but I mean that's the least of it. You know, it's just. I don't know. It was terrible.
Well, we don't have to.
No, it's okay. I'm exaggerating.
That. No. I doubt it. But so it doesn't sound like this is, you know, part of the way the Earth Church is thinking about its political work in the world now.
No, the political work is economic for one thing. What we're experiencing at the Earth Church is the East Village coming together to. Make an autonomous economy that lives on the garbage and the throwaways of the dying empire, and shares it with its radical sharing, radical forgiving, radical beginning of relationships with somebody who has arrived from the Sudan. You know, you give them what you can, and they give you what they can, and isn't that the kind of that's down the road just a piece for most of us? All this is going to break away. I mean, these interdependencies that are based on status and profit taking and so forth. We're like that Wile E. Coyote, like ran off the cliff and doesn't know he's going to fall, but then we see a farm far below. We know that he's going to fall a mile, and he continues to perform for the camera the way I'm performing for you right now.
I mean, we have to participate in the electoral system as it is right now. But we should have no illusions about it. And we ourselves are in a kind of prefigurative moment, right? We are seeing the future. We are experiencing the future in our small community in New York City, in which we turn to each other and we say, what can we do? Now, I'm not saying that it's on us as communities and individuals to do the work of government. They should do that work. But as far as I can tell, it's been some time since our government was really working for us. Right, was really helping us, and that we had that kind of security and relationship with our government.
Earthalujah,
so I'm just saying,
agreement.
You know,
there?
We have to get to work in two directions. One is to really do our very best in the electoral arena, but also knowing that we have to build the world we want, and we have to reclaim democracy from the ground up, because it's not reforming what we have now. And I mean, I know there's so much knowledge in this room. That is a heavy lift. It's not going well. It's not going well. So, I mean, vote, please. But also remember that, like, this government was built by humans, right? And it wasn't perfect when it was built the first time, right? But we can learn from that. And what these migrants teach us that's so remarkable and miraculous is the degree to which you can change your life, right? And it's so hard for us to remember that here. It's so hard to give up the abundance and the comforts. And I'm not saying we all need to sacrifice all of that. I'm just saying, remember, you also can experience radical change in your life. You know, we can all do that together. And one other little thing about electoral politics, wouldn't it be great? And I was speaking to our cousin Greta about this today, like, how about we reform electoral politics by just, like, for a while, having a moratorium on it being almost entirely men, and let the women, like, run the electoral politics for a while and see what happens, you know? Would that be great? We could start there. I mean, because we haven't tried that. So we're like, this is a big failure, but we haven't even tried that, have we? So let's do that.
Okay, let's do that.
Alexandria,
there are...
Cortez.
Okay. Yeah. There are a lot more questions, of course, we could discuss. I do want people in the audience to have a little time to ask questions of our guests. We have microphones. If you raise your hand, I will try to discern. Okay, we've got question here and here. So we've got Hannah's going to give you the mic there. And then Max, you want to come up here for Jonah?
Thank you. I'm first, yay. So grateful for all of this tonight, the discussion and the performance and the film. I wanted to go back to the film that some of us watched prior to this event and to singing. Because I feel like I was already getting that hit of what you have just been talking about the shift from parody to truth and sincerity and community. And that was coming so strongly through to me in the music,
yes,
like in the singing together, be it by a campfire or at a protest or, you know, in a hall. And so, yeah, if you could, that's very churchy to me. So that's an element or an aspect that still feels churchy, even as you're morphing into whatever is next. So if you can talk a little bit about the creation of the music, the performance of the music, et cetera.
Thank you so much for reminding me even of music at all. Thank you so much. Okay, so I can't say enough about music and how important it is to all of this work and how I think of music as like the original technology of democracy, that what happens when we sing together takes care of so many of the like odious and laborious tasks of having a meeting, say, like, oh, we have to get to consensus and we have to agree on a name or all the things you do in a meeting. But if you just sing with the person, if you just sing a song together, so much of that is taken care of and you can get to work in a different way. So yeah, number one, there's just this original technology that many people think came before talking, right? So I think singing is also the thing that makes really hard work sustainable. So the work of activism is impossible. We fail constantly. We make no money. It's rough, okay? And we keep doing it largely because we get to sing. I mean, it's really that simple. I'm not even being glib. I mean it. Like, that is the thing. Every Sunday, we're singing, and we're finding meaning together. We're tuning our bodies together. We're tuning our ears, our minds. We're reaching consensus. I mean, all this work of democracy building happens in just the singing of a simple song. It's incredible.
Can we sing a song?
Yeah, we can sing a song.
How about the First Amendment song?
Yeah, but what if we could sing something that other people could sing, too?
Yes.
Yeah. We'll do it at the end, I promise.
Okay. That's good. Judah, and then back.
Hi.
Hi.
Thank you both so much.
Thank you.
I have a short question, which is, talk a lot about experiencing the future now, that we're in a prefigurative moment, I think was the very potent phrase that just got said. And my question is, how do you feel about the apocalypse, and how do you think we're supposed to feel about the apocalypse? Because I sense, and maybe I'm wrong, I sense a little bit of excitement about it. Oh. That the radical shift that the future portends is something to be excited about, and I'm curious to hear if you think we're supposed to be excited about the apocalypse.
Well, Deborah Whiteplume invited us to she's a Lakota prophet, passed away now, but she said that the earth is going through an uprising and a radical change, and the earth invites the human beings to do this together. But at a certain point, she said, the door will close. And then the people that did not come through the door will not be with us. So we've been given the apocalypse is has a status because it's in the Christian narrative. It's in Revelations. But if you listen to the earth says we're dying all the time and we're being born all the time. And the earth says this to us when we go out into Forest Park, and just you can feel the life and the death flickering. It's happening all the while. It's the material. It's the intelligence. It's the orgasm. It's life. And so there's a little bit of using the apocalypse to some. I'll admit the way that we use Christian structures in time to run away from them, but we just want to gather everybody, you know. We get the joke together at the doorway. I have people shouting "Earthalujah," and that's it. You know, we go farther away.
But make no mistake, we are not excited about the apocalypse. And if I'm really honest with you, I'm going to say this: I think there was already an apocalypse. You know, there have been apocalypses, right? What was the genocide here in this land, if not an apocalypse? You know, what was the Holocaust? An apocalypse. What was the dropping of the atomic bomb? Those were apocalypses. So the idea that it's like this one thing, no, there's multiple apocalypses. I have always placed myself in a post-apocalyptic space. I have always felt I live, it already happened. You know, and that's where I orient my imagination. And I'm not excited about it, no. Because what is it? It's pain. It's pain and inequality. That's what it looks like to me. You know, so no. No excitement there.
At the back, right there.
I'm pretty loud, so I feel like this will work out. how do you suggest that someone...
Wait, excuse me. Can we actually give you the mic so we can hear it on the recording?
Yeah, sorry.
That's okay.
Excuse me. Okay.
Good job.
How do you suggest that one divorces themselves from consumerism when it is literally like the foundation of like the material world?
Oh man.
The foundation of the material world was the earth. Is that a trick answer?
No.
I don't think so. I don't think so. I think that's a real answer. But the old Lama Foundation is now devoted to permaculture. I mean, there are people that are in cyclical relationships with the local earth in a way that I think a lot of us will have to be as the big macro gas and oil structures break down. But consumerism is the fundamentalist religion of the United States, that it has persuaded much of the world to follow suit. consumer confidence is that belief system, and it's a terrible thing. Consumer confidence is a bad, bad thing. And so, you know, all the liberals, the corporate liberals, that's their language. The New York Times, that's its language. Consumers are happy, they're sad. The market's happy, it's sad. You know, they've made the market a person, sort of, you know, with moods and, like, psychological problems. So consumerism, which we, when we founded the Church of Stop Shopping, we knew that was our opponent. And we still believe that. It's just that we're not going to change consumerism by doing clever things with a renegade church.
No, but you can.
The earth is the power now.
And
the
also,
earth has the power.
But there's
to
practical.
Change.
There are practical things. I think the best and fastest way, you know, alienation is real, right? We're living in a. I don't know how to describe it anymore. We're living in a. You know what I'm talking about? Alienation is real. How do you disengage, or how do you disalienate? And I think the fastest way to do it is to look into another person's eyes, number one, at any moment. Just like in Billy's sermon, he was talking about that, right? To look into someone else's eyes. And then second, talking and listening. The original media, talking and listening. I talk, you listen. You talk, I listen. Those are two really good places to start.
And that's the earth. That's humans being intensely earthy. But from there, out to the ecosystem, into the soil, into the sky. And then what we have found is our direct action becomes not even a question of courage at that point. We can crawl our ass up a pipeline. It's not a courage at all. We are the earth. We're just agents for the earth now. We're not being correct. We're not being moral. We're not doing the right thing. We're just the earth. The earth involved in life making more life. Life making life.
One more question.
There's a gentleman.
Wait, how many? Here, there's a hand. Is there another one? There we go.
I was fortunate enough over Christmas time to visit Woody Guthrie in Tulsa, Oklahoma, the museum.
Oh, yeah.
And he used music to try to move America, and he did move America.
Yes, he did.
I'm very interested in Native American culture. I'm myself an Episcopalian, but I see a hole in Americans' soul. In America's soul, and I think Native American religion, where there were elders and there was care for the earth, helps heal what much of Western religion has missed. You know, Jesus and his disciples wanted to take care of people, and hospitality has always been the center of humanity. So your message about the earth is, again, I think in common with this land is your land, this land is my land.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
and
yeah.
I also believe that our humanity is like, as we sing together, as we invite people and have hospitality for others, that's what makes us human. So I don't really have a question, but I'm just trying to say that your message about Earth is similar to Native American philosophy. You don't poop in your nest. And Western civilization, I'm an engineer in computers, but...
Engineers, you know, really understand that, don't they?
You know, my mother taught me not, and she's not Native American, but you don't poop in your nest. So if I had to coalesce the message that all of us need to live our lives by is don't poop in your nest.
All right.
Thank you. That's profound. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
The man in the back row has a light on your head. See the man with the hand, his hand laterally across his chin, right there. Yeah, you just moved it. You moved that person that just moved you. You look just like Kurt Vonnegut. And
And Kurt used to come into our rehearsals in New York for years. He would come in, he would just sit there. And after a while, he would leave. Kurt!
That's part of the communion of saints. We could have talked about that.
Right.
Kurt Vonnegut would be in that.
So much to talk about. So much.
So we will leave it there.
Aww.
I know we have more. We do have a reception to follow. So there will be food and drink out here. And I believe Savitri and Reverend Billy will linger with us for a while, mm-hmm. and maybe you'll have a chance to talk with them. And so please stick around for that. But in the meantime, thank you so much.
You're
for being
so welcome.
With us.
You're so welcome.
Thank you.
I know one that everyone knows.
Thank
here.
You.
Row, row,
we
row,
love you.
Row gently down the stream.
Merrily, merrily,
merrily, merrily, life is but a dream. Row, 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 row your boat gently down the stream. Row, 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 row your boat gently down the stream. Merrily,
merrily, merrily, merrily, life is but a dream. Amen.
I forgot about this premise of a song.